Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. Our planet's atmosphere is home to extraordinary electrical activity. It's been known for decades that electric currents from the sun induce our planet's aurorae, a radical hypothesis originally proposed over a century ago by Christian Birkeland, which ultimately proved correct. And the profound influence of these electric currents, called Birkeland currents, has become increasingly undeniable to mainstream science. However, the electric universe has always proposed that Birkeland currents from the sun have a far greater effect on our planet's atmosphere, including its jet stream and wind patterns, than the scientific mainstream has ever considered. As we've noted, retired professor of electrical engineering Dr. Donald Scott developed a mathematical model of the structure of a Birkeland current, which can be identified visually as counter-rotating cylinders. We have suggested that the counter-rotation clearly seen at the poles of Jupiter, Saturn, Neptune, and in the earthly aurorae are the consistent indicators of the Birkeland current's influence. Today, Dr. Scott invites the Electric Universe community to explore the ways one might actually be able to track the presence of Birkeland currents in Earth's atmosphere.
It's been long suggested, as many of the folks who looked at Space News are aware, that back in the early part of the 1900s, Christian Birkeland suggested that electric current coming from the sun down into the poles of the Earth was the cause of the Earth's auroras. And he got a lot of flack from the astronomical community for saying that. But after World War II, when we sent rockets up into the upper atmosphere, we found out that exactly that was occurring. And so we know that he was correct in saying what he said. Well, anyway, in 2015, I presented what I call a Bessel function model of the form and structure of what those Birkeland currents might look like. In other words, were they like a stream of water from a garden hose, or what was it? Well, actually, the structure of the Birkeland current is quite complicated, quite complex. But generally, one of the most obvious properties of it is that it contains concentric counter-rotating regions. And so if you think of a pipe within a pipe within a pipe, and all these pipes are going in the opposite direction from the ones just inward or outside them, you get a general idea. And if something like that, with that property, hits the atmosphere, then generally, if it causes the aurora, which we now know it does, the aurora should have some sort of a counter-rotating property to it. And not necessarily visible all the time, but you should be able to see, oh, look, there's counter-rotation. That's right. That is the way that those things are formed. And of course, we've also seen supporting evidence for that by some of the massive videos of the North Pole of Saturn, the North Pole of Jupiter, and there is accumulating evidence that this is indeed what is happening. Well, the reason I'm kind of interested in talking to you this morning is that there is a website, which I think is an excellent website. If you go on there, you'll see this round circle, which is, of course, the Earth. So if you look down in the lower left-hand corner of that screen, you'll see the word Earth. Just click on that. It'll bring up a menu of things. So the first thing on the top is the date. And what I've selected is the wind at 10 hectopascals. A hectopascal is a fancy name for a millibar. So 10 millibars is very, very low pressure. So if you look down in that menu, you'll see scale and then source. And the source is U.S. National Weather Service. The control, you see a mode. Now, when it comes to mode, make sure you click on air. Air should be in a gold color. You can look at the ocean. You can look at chemistry, the particles in space. But air is what you want to look at. And the height, the next line down, way over on the right, you have the opportunity to click on 10 hectopascals, 10 millibars, which is way up. It's around, estimates vary, but I would say it's somewhere between 30 and 50 kilometers up. So it's really, really outer edges of our atmosphere. And the overlay that you want is wind, and the projection that you want is O. Well, if you do that, and then you want to get rid of that that menu, you just click on Earth, the word Earth again, and it'll go down. If you click on the globe, you'll see, and push on the globe, on a point on the globe, you'll see a little green circle. And wherever you click, you can move that. It looks like you move the world up. You will see that it rotates the globe, and you can get a look at the southern hemisphere. And if you look at that southern hemisphere, that's my ta-da, come to Jesus moment. That is obviously counter-rotation of those wind flows. There's a tremendously strong clockwise circulation of wind around the centered on the continent of Antarctica. And then as you go a little bit farther north, there's another sort of a vacant spot, which is the center of a very tiny, very weak vestigial counterclockwise flow. The flow around the South Pole is clockwise. We would normally call that a west to east flow. And then as you go still farther north, still south of the equator, you see a very, very strong east to west. You can see the equator that runs right through Ecuador and across the Pacific there. So there is no doubt that in the upper atmosphere of Earth, there is counter-rotation of the air in our upper atmosphere. So anyway, if we go down deeper into the atmosphere, all of a sudden the wind flow becomes distorted, and it's sort of a sinusoidal, sinuous kind of a flow. It's not a circular flow anymore. You can see that it's a chaos of wind flows, circular, sinuous, all sorts of stuff. And you say, well, why is that? Well, I submit that's because the wind distribution, the wind flows, are being disturbed by all sorts of things. The farther down you get, the closer to the surface you get, the more important land masses and storms, regions of high and low humidity, high and low pressure, all sorts of variants occur to disrupt that beautiful circular pattern. So let's, in fact, if you go all the way down to the surface, that's SFC, the one just to the left of 1,000, and go back and look at the Earth, you'll see that that's kind of what the looks like. There's a storm sort of off the off that peninsula that sticks out of Antarctica. It's a very interesting, and I think very educational kind of a website. But anyway, back to my main point, and that is looking at the wind at 10 millibars, way, way up there in the upper atmosphere, you can then go to the North Pole. Whoa, the North Pole is very different. You look there and you realize that there are two circular flows, one centered pretty much on the north end of Greenland. It's not a circular, it's more of an elliptic or hot dog shaped center to that circular pattern. And then over there, centered right about on the Bering Sea, between the Aleutian Islands and the Kamchatka Peninsula, there's another one, another center, if you will. That secondary one is weaker. You can see that the red colors, the purple, shows the strength of the flow. There's in vector calculus, there's an operator called the curl operator. If you look at your right hand and curl your fingers, like make believe you're picking up a screwdriver with your fingers curled around the handle and your thumb pointed down the blade of the screwdriver. If you sit your hand on that North Pole region with your fingers going in the direction of the purple flow, you can see your thumb is pointing up, outward. And if that Birkeland current is doing that, that says the current there is flowing out of the Earth. And then you look at the other one just to the left, the one that's over the Bering Sea, you have to push your thumb in a downward direction to have your fingers go in the direction of that flow. So that says there's a current going in, a less strong one. It's a sort of a vestigial current, but it's very strange that there are two, well, one Birkeland current that's split, and one going in one direction and one going in the other direction. And again, if you go back and rotate the globe and look down at the South Pole, then there's that major one, not quite as strong as the one at the North Pole, but the one circulating around Antarctica in a clockwise direction that would say that the current is going in, and that little vestigial one, that looks like a current would be coming out of the globe because the circulation is counterclockwise. I submit that these patterns are indicative, and I should say additional, substantially supportive evidence that my idea of what the Birkeland current structure looks like is indeed happening here on Earth. And the last space news we did was about this magnetic pole wandering around. Yes, well, these Birkeland currents can also wander around. I don't mean it's going to wander up into the equatorial regions or anything like that, but you can see from day to day that the size of these, the strength of these flows vary, and the location of their centers of these circular flows vary. And just as an electric arc would from a welding machine, the welder knows what he's doing, it'll wander all over the piece. So I leave you with that thought, and I think I submit that this is more additional evidence that the electric universe has opened the door, I think, to finding the answer to this big question is, how does the sun affect weather on the Earth? And this is, the answer is via the Birkeland current.